premise of this series of talks, of which the first two took place in mid-October with the presentation of Gita Kapoor, Katie Siegel, Chico Kekagolo, and myself and Dr. Ulrich Vilmes, was to sort of to take a broad look at the question of historical reconsideration of the landscape of what generally is known as post-war art. And that first presentation in many ways was, shall we say, an introductory session to this series of events that we'll be holding over the next few months. The second iteration of these dialogues brought together two eminent museum directors and curators, Francis Morris, the director of Tate Modern, and Casper Koenig, who was the founding director of Porticus in Frankfurt, and then the director of the Ludwig Museum, Museum Ludwig in Cologne. Both presenters, Casper Koenig and Francis Morris, were invited specifically to address the two exhibitions that each organized, separated by a span of about 13 years. For Koenig, it was the very important and famous exhibition, Westkunst, which he organized in 1981 in Cologne. And while I did not see the exhibition, each time I looked at a catalogue of that exhibition, I was always filled with envy, because this was a particular time in organizing exhibitions when you could have anything you wanted. And he had 16 Pollocks in the exhibition, 18 Dubuffets, multiple de Koonings and, and Rothkos. Well, fast forward 30 years later, 35 years later, well, it's become increasingly difficult to bring together such a large body of material in one exhibition body, partly having to do with the developments in the market, the shifts in scholarship, and so on. The presentation of Frances Morris was centered around an exhibition she organized in 1994 at the then Tate Gallery before the birth of Tate Modern. And that exhibition, Paris Postwar, Art and Existentialism, 1945 to 1955, was an attempt to sort of to map the immediate decade of the post-war era during a time when Europe was still under reconstruction, Europe was still recovering from the devastation of the war. So that exhibition was an attempt to bring together the thinking of artists and writers and to see perhaps whether the notion of humanism as seen through the lens of existentialism could bring to bear a new understanding of the motivations behind the production of art during this period. And this brings us to the third iteration of the series that we have, and it is my distinct pleasure to welcome our two speakers this evening, Rasheed Araeen, an eminent, artist and critic, and Eckhart Gillen, again, an eminent art historian and curator. Why did we choose to bring these two into dialogue? Well, the first has to do with a recent exhibition that just opened, organized by Eckhart Gillen and Peter Weibel, called Facing the Future, Art in Europe, 1945 to 1968. The show opened in Brussels over the summer and is currently on display at ZKM in Karlsruhe and will travel after Karlsruhe to Moscow. On the other hand is the exhibition organized in 1989 by Rasheed Araeen called The Other Story. Art in post-war Britain, the work of artists who had migrated to Europe and Britain in the immediate post-war period. Not all of them in the post-war period, because artists like Robert Moody were already in Europe, but nevertheless, were immigrants or emigres within the context of Europe. So these two exhibitions have proposed a new landscape or a different topography of post-war art in Europe. One, focusing on internal migrations within Europe itself. Artists moving from east to west, south to north, and vice versa, or artists who did not have the opportunity to migrate internally, in the case of artists from Eastern Europe, during this period. And of course, the very fertile ground around which artists from, the former colonies of England had settled in Britain in the post-war period, and the kind of work that they produced, and the kind of ideas that shaped their practice. So we are bringing together, Eckhart Gillen, I'll introduce both of them now, and Rasheed Araeen, to help us tease out the trajectories of the development of post-war art in the years from 45 to, shall we say, the present. Well, Eckhart Gillen is an art historian and curator who has lived in Berlin since 1971. I think, this is a very pivotal period, if you will, in the city. And he studied art history, German, and sociology at the University of Heidelberg, and where he also received his doctorate from the Department of Philosophy at the university. I should say that Heidelberg somehow also plays a very interesting role in this exhibition in relation to the series of lectures delivered by the philosopher Karl Jaspers a few months after the end of the war, and which raised very important questions about the situation of German citizens in the construction of National Socialism. That series of lectures was subsequently published the following year in 1946 as the Schuldfrage, the question of German guilt. So that is, I recall this simply because those lectures were delivered at the University of Heidelberg when Jaspers was re-invited to return after being expelled from the university in 1937. Well, Gillen has organized numerous exhibitions and published widely on Russian, American, and German art of the 20th century. Among his exhibition catalogues and books are America, Traum and Depression, 1940, German Art from Beckmann to Richter, Images of a Divided Country, in 1997, Art of the Two Germanies, Cold War Cultures, 1945 to 1989, and Feindliche Brüder, the Kalte Krieg, and the deutsche Kunst, 1945 to 89, and many others. And as I mentioned, the exhibition that he just opened, Facing the Future, Art in Europe, 1945 to 1968, sort of continues in the tradition of historical examinations that have been central to his curatorial and art historical project. Rasheed Araeen, for many of us, is a legendary figure. I should say that my own personal entrance into the curatorial world owes a lot to the pioneering work done by Rasheed, not only as the founder of the very important, critical journal, Third Text, where at a very early period of my career I had the rare opportunity to publish, but also because Rasheed's thinking, his intellectual activism, as it were, has been a very important example, for how to work from within the edifice of the canon, and perhaps not so much to dismantle that edifice, but to maybe to reorganize his operating system. And so Rasheed, to my thinking, has been really quite is a central figure. Rasheed was born in Karachi, Pakistan, and moved to London in the early 1960s. And he was trained as a civil engineer, an artist, and is also a writer and an inventor. As an artist, Rasheed's work has spanned, different, aspects of contemporary art, beginning with his early work in Karachi, in Pakistan, up until his arrival in England. And he's also a participating artist in the exhibition here. Rasheed's, founding work, with the art journals Black Phoenix, which he founded in 1978, and Third Text, as I mentioned, in 1987, and then Third Text Asia in 2008, have each been pivotal. His latest book, Art Beyond Art, Aesthetics, a Manifesto for the 21st Century, was published in 2010. As I mentioned, Rasheed organized in 1989, around the same time that the exhibition Magicienne de la Terre was also organized, the exhibition The Other Story, which will be the subject of his presentation this evening. So help me welcome Rasheed and Eckhart Gillen. Thank you.
What I'm going to do, show you these slides, pictures from the exhibition I organized in 89 with some commentary. But I want to give you a brief introduction just to say why it was necessary to have that kind of exhibition. I call it modernism and the other artists in Britain. Modernism in South Africa arrived when Ernest Mancoba refused the government commission to make traditional African sculpture. He then left the country and arrived in Paris in 1938. In order to have a dialogue with his contemporaries, as he had himself put it. In Paris, he came under pressure to follow what was then called Negro art. Despite the fact that it was then very fashionable thing among the Paris art world, Mankoba also defied it and rejected it persistently, and instead produced one of the most innovative and original work within the trajectory of mainstream modernism, also becoming one of the pioneers of Cobra movement. But when we look into history books, you will not find his name anywhere. My point with this introduction is to highlight the problem which all artists from Asia, Africa, and the Caribbean faced when they came to the West, particularly to Britain, who were collectively shown in the other story in 1989 to deal with this problem. When the artists from Asia, Africa, and the Caribbean came to Britain, they did not bring with them what would show only their racial, cultural, or national origin, but the modern ideas which were introduced to their countries by colonialism. With these ideas, they in fact entered the modern mainstream, joined their white contemporaries, and pushed the idea of the mainstream beyond its inheritance of colonial formation, or what is called Eurocentricity, producing what could be understood only within the context of post-war Britain and its history. Some of the artists did in fact become successful, but only professionally, because when it came to the understanding and evolution of their work, it was considered outside the history which produced it, with the result the official institutionally recognized history of art in post-war Britain is still exclusively the achievement of white artists. Although the other story included only non-white artists, its aim was not to assert their separation from their white contemporaries, or to create a separate category of art based on racial or cultural differences, as they were treated and seen by art establishment. Its real aim was only to show what was in fact institutionally removed and missing from the history of mainstream art in Britain. The other story project was the first step. I repeat, I think this is important to remember. The other story project was the first step towards the integration of all artists within the same history to produce subsequently and ultimately an inclusive art history representing the true and whole achievement of the multiracial and multicultural British society. It would then also provide a model for redefining and rewriting the whole history of modernism beyond the legacy of the imperialist formation and construction of modern art history. But even after 27 years, this hasn't happened, as there is still a tremendous resistance to any fundamental change in the system. How can this be otherwise without the system as a whole undergoing decolonization? But I haven't given up the struggle, my hope or ambition. Thank you. I can show you. Yeah. This is the outside Hayward Gallery showing the other story exhibit inside. This is the first room of the show, the work of I have a problem with my memory. Ronald Moody from Jamaica. Ronald Moody come from a respectable middle class professional family in Jamaica. He came to Britain in 1922, although Cho is post-war, but his work continues in Britain in the post-war period. He came to Britain to train himself in dentistry. He wasn't interested in art. He had no training in art. While in his spare time, he went to British Museum. When he looked at sculpture, particularly from Egypt, he was so overwhelmed, he decided to start doing sculpture himself. He went around, bought some wood, and started carving. By the end of, I think it was 30s, he became extremely professional. But nobody wanted to show him. So he moved to Paris. Although he moved to Paris, his first show was in Holland. He was so successful that he bought his vodka and bread around. And soon after, while he was still living in Paris, soon after, of course, the German troops entered Paris, and he had to run. And there was no way to escape. And he had to go through Spain on foot with his wife. It took him 1 year before he reached Britain again. And by that time, the whole thing, you know, affected his health. And he didn't do much carving after, but he developed other means and other methods of making sculpture. Let me carry on. If I go in detail, it will take hours. The one on the right-hand side is Avan Paris from Sri Lanka. In 1942, a group of artists, musicians, writers, poets, dramatists got together and declared their alliance with modernism, with modern ideas. It was called Group 42, and Avan was a member of that group. Soon after the end of the war, he came to Britain, and these are few of his works here. On the left, again, is, I'm sorry, I can't give you enlargement of these. I just give you some idea of the show. On the right-hand side, you can see one portrait of a woman, which in fact he did before the war, while he was still in Sri Lanka. In India, there was also a great yearning for modernity. And soon after the independence of India, a group of artists got together and called themselves a progressive group. And Francis Souza was one of the pioneering members of the group. Point I'm making here is this. In both cases, Sri Lanka and India, artists came forward to express their alliance with modern ideas. They were not carrying on their own tradition. Which eventually brought them to Britain. In the same way, Picasso had to leave Spain and come to Paris. There was no other difference. All this talk about diaspora of black artists is complete nonsense. We should look at the migration historically, because the intellectuals, artists, poets, whatever you call them, always throughout history migrated to the center of power, where they have more facilities or more institutional support to promote and support their ideas. So it was the reason why Picasso left. It was the reason Francis Sousa and Urban Paris left the countries, and subsequently all other artists also came to Britain for the same reason. Again, you can see more work of Francis Sousa, and there are few works in the show here as well. On the left, on the right-hand side and in front is Abhinav Chandra. What is important about Abhinav Chandra is that before he came to Britain, he was a traditional landscape artist. But when he found himself in a different environment in Britain, he completely changed. And he developed a style which was unique, using curvilinear formation forms in his work. On the left is another artist from India, Avtar Jeet Dangal. Unfortunately, there's a mix-up in the sequence, but don't worry about that. What is interesting about Avtar Jeet Dangal, he came from a peasant background, very poor peasant background. When the village people found out his interest in art, they gathered together and funded his education. Eventually, he ended up in Chandigarh, learning how to make a sculpture, and eventually in Britain. Unfortunately, I can't show you his early work, which in my view, much more interesting. On the right-hand side of this picture is the Chinese artist, Li Wankia. He is from Formosa, Taiwan, so chair. He spent some time in Milano and Bologna before he came to Britain in the early 60s. His work involved participation. You can actually touch his work. Unlike most of the work you will see, don't touch the work. But this one you can touch and move around the disc. He did have shows in the 60s, which became a very important gallery, Listen Gallery. But the rumor is that he had a quarrel with the director, and he got so fed up with the art world, he left London and went to north of England and got a rundown house in a remote area and renovated it himself, brick by brick, and turned into a gallery where he lived and worked all his life, until he died, of course. This is some of my works, both, and there's the other slide. This is outside. I will only say something, a few sentences. First, for 40 years, nobody believed in Britain. Not only that, did not believe, there was a hostility against me that I claimed I did minimalist work in the 60s. Nobody wanted to believe, not even Tate. Tate only believed and recognized in 2007, 40 years after. The work you see here is of 1965. Other point I would make, I wasn't pursuing minimalism. There was no minimalism in 65. My interest was in symmetry, in geometry, in symmetry, whose roots are in the work I did in Pakistan before coming to Britain. There was also influence of my being an engineer, because in engineering you deal with structures which are symmetrical. Here you see Monohatum in outside the gallery. I suppose you all know who is Monatum. He's a Palestinian, came to Britain in 75 on holidays. But while she was in London, the war broke out in Lebanon, so he decided to stay and went to art school. Yeah, this is Gavin Jenches from South Africa. He is a so-called of mixed race. In South Africa, they had three categories of people: white, black, and colored. Colored were those who were mixed race. Or Asian. Asian were also called colored. Somehow I managed to go to school there, in art school, despite the fact that blacks and colored people were banned entering the art school. They could only practice traditionally. Another work on the left is Gavin Jenches. Gavin now lives in Norway, and mostly he was engaged in curating shows. In the early 70s, we entered a very interesting phase in the history of art in Britain. It was the time when the children of African Asian descent had grown up and wanted to go to art school. And they realized what they were being taught had a racist undertones. So they, instead of attending the classes, they grouped themselves and declared they want to do black art, which was the beginning of black art movement in Britain in the early 80s. I mentioned 70 by the time when they wanted to go to school. And the work you see is by Keith Piper. Also, 70s was the period when black struggle, which was very much influenced by what was happening in America, but also have Britain's own reasons. For example, there were riots in 58, what they call the first racial riots. And they basically, it was the uprising of whites against the new black immigrants. And their slogan was, keep Britain white. Although the movement in which the fascism mostly was also involved, it was stopped institutionally, but the idea of keep the British white is still there, particularly with the triumph of Trump in America. So besides black struggle, there was also struggle of women. That was very important because they realized that despite their practice, their success, they were ignored in history books. Besides other social economic factors. And here is Lubina Himid. Mostly her work is a critique of Picasso. All these work are Lubina Himid. Originally, she is from Zanzibar, which is part of Tanzania. Very small work. On the left is Shamsa. Shamsa also belonged to a group of artists in Pakistan who also got together in Lahore in pursuit of modern ideas. And he came to Britain in 56. While attending the lecture of famous art historian Gombrich, he realized not only Gombrich gave only few pages to the whole East. He called Islamic art as a form of decoration. He was so shocked and shattered, he destroyed all his work, which was, of course, influenced by the Western artists, particularly Cubism, and looked for a new kind of work where he could reaffirm his identity as an artist. And he found that in the work of Paul Klee. So his work was somewhat influenced by Paul Klee. There are a couple of very interesting works are in this exhibition. on the left on the wall is Uzu Egono from Nigeria. He's also a very interesting story. As a young boy, he was very interested in drawing. When some of the colonial administration found out his interest in art, they sent him to England. He was very young. He had not even finished his school. He was one of the first artists, person to come to England after Ronald Moody. He arrived in 45 and went to school in Britain. And he was also, I think, a first artist, non-white artist in Britain, who was educated in Britain. Donald Locke. Very interesting artist from Jamaica. He was initially a ceramist. Then he got interested in the work of Brancusi, and he began to eliminate figuration, and some of his work was almost black painting, but he had no success in Britain, so he got fed up, went to America. Like all other artists, who were totally forgotten in Britain, he was also completely unknown. He became known only after the other story show. On the right hand side is a Japanese girl, very interesting artist. She hasn't made it anything. I'm sorry, in terms of successful, I think she has given up now. But in the 80s, she was doing very interesting. She would go pick up things from the escapes, from the garbage dumps, and make works. We're almost coming at the end. Big panel is a work of an Indian artist, Muslim Indian artist, who also had a problem with identity, because when you're brought up in a racist society, you begin to have that kind of problem. So he looked around and found where he could attach himself or which could inspire him. And he found something in Dante's poetry with which he could identify himself. So he began to do series of work on Dante, inspired by Dante, not on Dante. Oh, we are going back, sorry. That's what I meant. There was a problem with this sequence. I think this is the work on the left, is the Aubrey Williams from Guyana. Another very interesting artist. This is not a good example of his work here. Eminent art historian, white art historian, according to him, Aubrey Williams' work is one of the most important work after abstract expressionism. What happened in 1956 when abstract expressionism was introduced in Britain, and Aubrey was there, and Aubrey was one of those people who were inspired by the American example, among which were like a Patrick Hiram and Holland and Iris, all recognized they had their retrospective in the state, but he never had a major show in Britain. Even now, he can't sell it. He died about 20 years ago. Even now, his gallery can't sell his work for more than £10,000, which is a joke. Oh, in front is Frank Bowling. I believe Frank is going to have a show here next year. Very interesting artist. He came as a young boy to Britain, and he had no intention of doing art. He enrolled himself in the Air Force, and for some reason among them was also racism, he was thrown out. So he started wandering around in a famous fashionable street in London called King's Road. He was a young, handsome boy. He was spotted by some girls and told him, "Why don't you do modeling?" So they dragged him to Royal College and he became a model there. And this is by his own interest and arts, beginning of his interest. Then he went and did the foundation course, and he did enroll himself in Royal College. The rumor is that he had an affair with the wife of one of his teachers, and he was thrown out. But somebody else, other professor, in the Slade School of Art took him up and he enrolled him, and then he came back to Royal College. The point, interesting point is that when he was part of the group of artists from Royal College, which when they left school were called British Pop, which included David Hockney among other artists. He was part of that group. When it came to the recognition of what was pop in Britain, French was excluded. He was so fed up, he left Britain and went to America, where he developed a new kind of work inspired by the color field painting. Oh, Belroz Khanna on the left. Another interesting story, Indian artist who had no interest in art. He came to Britain in 63 to do his postgraduate in English literature. But he was somewhat late and he couldn't get into the college. So he had a spare time to kill. And he started doodling, out of which came one of the most interesting work done in the 60s. Okay, I almost finished. That one of the examples. Iqbal Jafri on the left, very interesting, avant-garde artist. In 61, he did a blank canvas, except one corner. He wrote the name of a famous film actress in his own language, Nilo, which nobody could understand. Oh, David Medalla, you will see down there. And that's very interesting. Okay, thank you.
Very happy that I can present this exhibition, which started in a very difficult time in 2014. You remember the Maidan in February, and in March we had the occupation of the peninsula Krim, and it exactly at that moment I got a letter from Moscow, and an artist and writer, Maxim Kantor, asked me to take over this idea to make an exhibition which proves that Europe is a unity that can't be divided again. So I was very happy that I found as a partner Peter Weibel in the ZKM, who on the phone immediately said, yes, we do that. And then the next partner was Paul, was in Brussels, and I start with Brussels now. You see here the famous Palais des Beaux-Arts by the Art Nouveau artist Victor Horta. And so we had the beginning in Brussels because Moscow had difficulties with the money, with raising the money, because the state was refusing to finance this exhibition. That's why Moscow is now the third, the last venue. I think the idea of the exhibition is very simple. Its first part is looking back, it's trauma and memory. The second part is the Cold War. The third part is looking into the future, and there is a dialectic of new realisms and new idealisms, new visions. And we finish with 1968, different from the exhibition here in this house, because 1968 was the end of these experiments, of these utopian ideas, of this dérivé, of this finding new ways of art, and also of participation of the public and opening the art world, because then the idea was a new life, not a new art, not new art forms, but new life immediately. So that's the end, 68 with a question mark, end of utopias. You see here, this is a timeline, which is very important in both venues, also in Brussels and in Karlsruhe. And this is the beginning. You have the timeline on both sides here. And then you come to the beginning of the exhibition with Zadkin, the famous Zadkin Destroyed City from 1947, the model, which was realized in the early 50s in Rotterdam. And then you open and you come in at the exhibition, and the first thing you are seeing are two drawings by Picasso, the study for Man with Lamp, which was a reaction to the exhibition by Arno Breker in May 42, and the beginning of his drafts were in June, July 42. So he was doing a opposition to this Breker figures with his antique model, and he was trying a protecting figure. And the situation was that Picasso was working in the German-occupied Paris. And you see here the installation of the first two spaces. You find yourself in a kind of labyrinth. You can't look through. It's very, showing and demonstrating the isolation of the artists. In the exile or in this occupied Paris, for example, you see here another Picasso nude on a divan from 44, looking like a corpse in a crematorium. And you see here, for example, Beckmann's transportation of the Sphinx, and Vautrier here on this side, the hostage. There is a sculpture, a head of a hostage. You have here landscape of the formless by Dupuffet, which looks like a field of a battlefield and an archaeological excaving ground. You have Rouault, Homo homini lupus, and here is Beckmann again. And in the back, you see two Tatlins, the artist who was a constructivist in the 20s, is doing this paintings now with a knife in a piece of meat. Or you have Paul Nash, Battle of Britain, and Karl Hofer, The Dance of Death. You have a Russian artist. So it's all mixed East and West. It's proving that there is nothing like this division of abstraction on the West and avant-garde on the West, and on the other side, socialist realism. It's proving that on both sides, they had the same breaking of a taboo of memory, of looking back, of mourning, which of course the official party line was looking forward, looking and building up the new countries, the new Germany, for example, or the new Soviet Union. You have here a very interesting painting by Hans Richter, Stalingrad, Victory in the East. And you see here Bernard Buffet, and here is Bernard Buffet, two naked men with Gerhard Marx, bound Prometheus. And here you see on the left side, the pain image by Grieshaber, and on the right side, you see two paintings by Roflewski. He is a young Polish artist, child with dead mother and execution against the wall. He did 10 paintings like that in 1949, and he couldn't show them. But later in 1955, there was a chance to do that. And in the background, you see an early Rittich car crucified from 1959. And here's a looking back, Sutherland, for example, also a crucifixion, taking up this Christian iconography again. And here you see other paintings by this Polish artist like Marek Oberländer, silhouette on white background, and Teresa Majlerowicz and Stefan Giorowski. This was a group of young students which studied in Krakow, and their wish was to do an exhibition against war and fascism, which was not allowed in 49, but then possible in 1955. And that marks the end, the official end of socialist realism in Poland, very early, much earlier than in East Germany, for example. You have Karol Appel, Constant, the refugees. You have Armando, and here there are some sculptures by Henry Moore, for example, The Falling Warrior, which is here from Munich, from the Pinakothek. And you see here again the situation, and here is the looking back and to this Polish artist and Werner Tübke. You see here the Sidur on the left side, and the middle is Alina Zapochnikov, exhumed, and Santomirskaya Majdanek in the foreground. And here is a Hungarian artist, Desu Kornis, Antithesis, and Karl Friedrich Klaus from East Germany, remembered poem by a Jewish girl. You hear the same situation. And here you see Jean-Paul Riopel, unfinished painting, The Skin of the Bear. And here is Gutuso, who had an exhibition in 1951 in East Berlin. And that was very important, the realismo. Realismo as an opposition to socialist realism, keeping to the truth and keeping to authenticity and not illusions and propaganda. Then there were several campaigns, for example, for the monument to the unknown political prisoner in 1952-53 in London. And these are, for example, on the right side, Reg Butler was a final maquette, and he was a winner of this campaign. This is Bernhard Heilige. And another one was on Buchenwald. This is Fritz Kramer on the Buchenwald Memorial. Another example is here, you see Gabriele Mucki, The Mothers of Gorla. This is a typical example for this kind of realismo, because that was a bombing raid of American of the American allies, and they should bomb a factory, but they were hitting a school, and the children died. And for the realismo, it was important to keep that, because it's the children are dead, and it doesn't matter which part and which side it was. It is part of the truth to document that in this painting. Then you have this Budapest arrest in 56, and you know the official symbol of the peace movement, of the communist peace movement, was a dove by Picasso, which is the most aggressive animal, he said, but they used it for the peace campaign. And you see on the left side, Harald Metzkes. He was one of the young students who saw the Gutuso and saw this exhibition in 51. And you see the weeping girls with a dead dove on her lap. Here it's again. So this is a very strong, I think a very strong metaphor to what happened. The end of the peace was by the occupation of Hungary. Then we come to this is part of the Cold War, and you see here this parted space here, and you see on the right side the abstraction, and you see on the left side Fallström, which has a wonderful environment here in this exhibition. You see here the subject matter of the atomic threat that is the same year in 58 done by Hans Grundig. and you have Leche in the background. And on the other side, in the same year in Düsseldorf, you have a triptych by Karl Otto Goetz with the same subject matter. It was a year as Strauss and Adenauer tried to get nuclear weapons for the Bundeswehr. We come to this section of new realisms, which are very hard looking behind the facades of the economic miracle and the consumerism of the Western society, but also you find examples from the East on the right side, Mikhail Roginsky, for example, the matches, and this very interesting, just a red wall with a socket. It's also Mikhail Roginsky, so we come to these material paintings. In the foreground is it's Paik. Here you see Tim Ulrich's skin film, tanning human skin as filmic process. And on the right is a first living work of art. It was in 65 already. You have here, which you also have in the exhibition here, John Latham, The Laws of England. And you see in the background a work, but I see, I think there is another one. You have Aman and you have Hermann Nietzsche on top left. So now we come to the new idealism, the new visions, which also are in East and West. You have Heinz Mack in the background. You have Yaroslav Kulishek, The Must, and you have Infante Arana. They are members of this Tyshenye group in Moscow, and they are all fascinated by the technology and by the nuclear power, by space travel, by this kind of Kubernetes, and they were fascinated of the chance, not by the text or the theory of Marx and Lenin, but by the power of technology to realize communism. And Khrushchev in 61 announced for the last time the communism in 20 years for 1980. And that was the last time they really believed that, and there was a strong belief in society. You see here Yuri Slotnikov, Geiger counter, Jankilevsky, Torso, it's a woman computer, a robot, Rima Tsarnaevskaya, and in the background, Eric Bulatov, early work, Street, 1966, and Ernst Neiss-Westny, Cosmonaut. Then you find Françoise Morellet, Random Repartitions, a very abstract kind of, using different colors, 40% blue, 40% red, and playing with that, or Victor Vasarely beside that. And very interesting was also that Tong Li was realizing his metamatic machines in the moment of the triumph of informal art on the second Documenta in 1959. He did that to the same time in July in Paris, and proving that the metamatic machine can do this very individual, very subjective kind of drawing or painting. And okay, we have here Huintong, some of the Belgian artists. And then we come to the last room, which is the 1968. You have here on the left side Penck, The Fall in 1960. The Stalin Memorial falls down 1 year before they really were removing all Stalin memorials and changed names like Stalinstadt to Eisenhüttenstadt in East Germany, for example. And you have here on the left side down Bremen, with a painting of the founding of the group, sitting around the table. And on the right side is the end of the Gruppspur which was also member of the Situationist International, rien ne va plus, nothing goes anymore. And then you see Uecker with the barricade. You see these very aggressive works, Otto Mühl on the left side, Fire and the Coal Business, Villagely, and and here it's another one that's the Equipo Realidad, Realidad, La Divina Proportion, the Divine Proportions, with a soldier. And of course, there were always a lot of films, and you see here Protas with some works, this famous film he did, Rain, and Draft for a Text. And finally, Harald Metzges again with the painting Barza Cain from 1968, which was a testimony, or it was a statement against the invasion of Prague by the Warsaw Pact troops. And then some photographs in the end. And now I just show you some images from the second venue in Karlsruhe. You see here the ZKM. ZKM is it was a weapon, Deutsche Waffen- und Munitionsfabriken, was built between 1915, in the middle of the First World War, and 1918. And this is a chance here in a fab, in a factory, not to have a chronological going around, but to have fields, have the possibility to show things one by the other, and quite different possibilities. Like you see here, when you come in, you see first Sutkin again and some photographs of destroyed cities. And then you can decide to go to the right. You have this subject matter of the nuclear catastrophe with, you see Hans Grundig here. And when you go left, this is the subject matter of the Shoah, of the genocide of the European Jews. And you see here some views from top down, and here again is the timeline integrated in the into the exhibition, not in the beginning, but integrated during. You see the timeline going through the exhibition here. For example, is a film on the Nuremberg trial, and this is interesting when you look this sketch. It's by Churchill, and he says Europe, it's okay, and Europe should develop, and on the side of Europe is, on the one side, right, is the United States, and left is Britain. Britain is a continent on itself. That was his famous speech in September 1946. You see, this is his exhibition I mentioned in 1955, Against War and Fascism. And you see a lot of artistic events and political and economic events. This is, for example, the new Nova Tendencia in Zagreb, which was a kind of on the neutral territory of Yugoslavia, was a meeting point for the networks of artists from East and West, from Italy, from Germany, from Russia and Hungary, and so on and so on. They were meeting there as a kind of a alternative biennale. As I say, the Venice Biennale, it's old-fashioned. The real avant-garde is in Zagreb, and that happened really with first computer art and so on. You see here, we have not forgotten the first book printed in 1959 on the genocide, and it was used by artists. It was used by Brock and by Fostel. You see here a new constellation of Buchenwald, Kramer, and Sasnovnikov, and you see, in the middle is the middle of the exhibition is the question of Adorno: is it possible to make art after Auschwitz, after Hiroshima, after the Gulag? And this is just to think about. Then you find on the other side Ivo Gattin. He was an artist who was destroying his artworks, and this is the idea of many artists, that we have to destroy art before you can make new art, because what happened was a break of civilization, it was a break of all culture, and we can't go on. That was Adorno's speech in Darmstadt in 1950 and 51. And here you see, that's also interesting, Yves Klein, one of the anthropometries, and on the right side, it's a photograph of a man who is only a shadow in the wall. And that was something Yves Klein was thinking about. He was in Hiroshima, and he brought this photograph, and he was taking up this idea in his anthropometries. And there is one big one, it's called Hiroshima. We couldn't show that, it was not possible to get it. This is a film which you also show, Hiroshima, Mon Amour. All this material kind of works. We have here twice socialist realism. On the right side is Lichet. He was a communist, member of the Communist Party, and left is Steinecker. But Lichet was trying and proving with the workers in the Renault factory, sitting in the canteen and looking and hearing what the workers say, and they say, no, with these hands you can't work. He was disappointed, but he kept to his style. He kept to his work, and he was not trying to instrumentalize his work against Steinecker did that. It's Mayakovsky by Schönebeck, Grieshaber again. You have Penck, the passage that was exactly the self-portrait of an artist between East and West, between this authority of the party and his individuality. You have here the same situation in a different setting. And there you look down to the visions, the new visions. You have here the new realisms and Fontana and so on. Also destroying the canvas, you have a look into the second floor with the concept art, minimal art, the participation art. Also a group which is nearly forgotten, Gorgona from Slovenia, which I think is a very important artwork. And you see here further kind of concept art by Mangelos, the denial of painting, it's called here. Or you see here Fostel with his first painting using a TV set in 1958. And you see here all kinds of action art, of performance, films, documents. Here, for example, there are always these magazines and so on. Also, Gustav Metzger, in 1961, his first performance of anti-destructive art, using acid to destroy the canvas. And again, Utopia, 1968, is a film by Guy Debord, and here the Czechoslovakian radio. And here is a kind of concept art by Brako Dmitrievich called the accidental drawing, the accidental painting, and the accidental sculpture. Yeah, I'm coming to the end. Here you see kind of arte povera, Albert Sorio's Kins with Resistance, and Pistoletto on the right side, and here Calzolari, Untitled Light in the background, and Luciano Fabro, Circle Every Tango. I thank you for your listening me, and we can discuss.
Thank you so much, Eckhart and Rasheed, for your presentations. I think in the interest of time, I'm not going to dwell too much in trying to sort of to tease out in any extensive fashion the two exhibitions. But it's safe to say that in these two presentations, we are not only confronted with a vision of you know, post-war art, we are in fact confronted with a vision of Europe as a site for the articulation of what constitutes the field of art in the post-war period. It is very obvious that Eckhart's work, sort of, you know, the exhibition with Peter Weibel proceeds from what one could call an attempt to decanonize the history of post-war art while still rendering, if you will, the diversity of practices that informed the making of art after catastrophe, as it were. And of course, it's very interesting that the Facing the Future is bookended by, you know, catastrophe on the one hand, and on the other, you know, the kind of idea to sort of to resist the way in which historical memory had, you know, in a sense, become a tool of state and institutional fields. And in the context of the other story, I think what is for me very clear is not just necessarily an attempt to recuperate forgotten figures, to recuperate histories that have been rendered invisible, you know, through different forms of opacity, if you will, but an attempt to sort of to fold into the discussion about modernism the question of migration, the question of cosmopolitanism, that, you know, that the field of art, modernism as it were, from the point of view of Rasheed, is really a scene of circulation, is a network of many participants, people moving from different places, you know, albeit that if you want visibility, you have to go to the site of power. And here, the, you know, power had, both to do with the institutional landscape, you know, fed by capital, fed, obviously, you know, by different structures of domination. But I thought it would be interesting to sort of to read very quickly a quote from V.S. Naipaul's 1987 novel, published 2 years before Rasheed's, exhibition, which I find really, quite instructive in sort of exploring some of the things that Rasheed, talked about. And here's the quote. It says, and this is one of the protagonists speaking. Because in 1950 in London, I was at the beginning of that great movement of peoples that was to take place in the second half of the 20th century, a movement and a cultural mixing greater than the peopling of the United States, which was essentially a movement of Europeans to the New World. This was a movement between all continents. Cities like London were to change. They were to cease being more or less national cities. They were to become cities of the world, modern-day Romes, establishing the pattern of what great cities should be in the eyes of islanders like myself and people even more remote in language and culture. They were to be cities visited for learning and elegant goods and manners and freedom by all the barbarian peoples of the globe, people of the forest and desert, Arabs, Africans, Malays. I think it's very instructive to sort of to think about the very context of post-war Europe that was not about recovery and construction, but about movement and what it meant for this shift between different zones of work and life, and how art was produced, through that. So I thought that it would be interesting, Rasheed, whether you and Eckhart, can find a common ground between your two, historical projects. And if there is, can you speak to that?
No. I tell you why. My friend here, he is talking within the context of recognized artistry. The other story is not part of my artistry. It's outside. Unless until it enters into discourse of artistry, we can't find a common ground.
Well, is it because you know?
Common ground is there.
Okay, the common ground is there.
Yeah, it's there because in actuality there was a dialogue, but that dialogue was suppressed. It didn't allow to develop into discourse, which went beyond Eurocentricity. That's the problem we are still facing.
Okay. Eckhart.
Well, the exhibition was from the very beginning very occupied by the idea of a new division of Europe. It came from Moscow, and that's why you're right, but this was all in our mind that Europe is divided in this official socialist realism and on the other side in abstraction, which came from America and was dominated by America and Pollock as the hero. But it all is not true. Pop art started much earlier in 47 by Paolozzi, and he was an Italian artist living in London, and he was a sculptor, and he was trained in Paris, and then he was working in England. And the idea that the artists built a network, beside all these terms of Cold War and of the Iron Curtain and all that thing, that this network was working and was functioning, I think this is an important thing, and that the artists were in a way really questioning the taboos of not looking back, of mourning, of looking forward and to rebuild the countries and so on. This, I think, is something we really need now, very, very urgently, that the artists are not manufacturers of nice artworks and for a growing and wonderful functioning investment art market, but hitting the problems which, of course, are, in this case, European problems. In that time, now it's totally different. I mean, speak about the time before 68.
Well, if I may be provocative, I should say maybe there is a common ground. Mm-hmm. And that common ground is somehow, bridged by post-war here in House of Kunst between, Rashid's exhibition, in which many of the artists who appeared in Rashid's exhibition are also included in our show, and many of the artists in your show. In fact, we were chasing the same works. So now I realize that some of the works I wanted ended up in yours. we were chasing the same works, and many of the artists in your show are also in ours. So there